Greetings. Today is March 28th, 2020. And right now, as you know, we are in the midst of a crisis, and it's the coronavirus crisis. And in some aspects, I'm thankful for this wake-up call. And I would like to share a message with you today, and my message is directed more towards Seventh-day Adventists. And so if you're not a Seventh-day Adventist, that's okay. But I would like to share something God has put upon my heart. And before I begin, let's have a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, this world seems to be falling apart, and yet this is the time that your people need to pull together. And so, Lord, as I share these thoughts, I pray that you would bless my mind, my speech, and my words, and the hearts and the minds of those who may be listening, that all of it may be for edification and encouragement and caution as we enter into the final scenes of this earth's history. And so I ask that you please would bless our time together this morning. And may your blessings be upon those who are called to finish this work. May your spirit be with us, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. In my words, I pray a encouragement and yet a caution. And the message I would like to share with you is one that most of you are familiar with. And the scene begins in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 1. Now, Jesus had just left the temple for the last time, and he had laid before the leaders of Israel their sins and their crooked paths. And his plea was not to condemn them, but that they would give their hearts over to God before it was too late. And he said to them, I leave unto you your house desolate. Those would be some very difficult words to hear. And it was for the disciples. And in spending time with Christ, they often saw the conflict between the Jewish leaders and Christ, and it was puzzling to them. And again, it was. As Jesus took them to the Mount of Olives, the disciples, they pointed down below to the temple and the temple buildings. And Jesus said to them that, I tell you that there shall not be one stone left upon another that shall not be cast down. The disciples were puzzled about this, and they said, when will this be, and what will be the signs of your coming? And so in Matthew chapter 24 and 25, Jesus shares the signs of his coming to give us preparation to be prepared for this time. And one of those stories begins that I would like to share with you, and one that you're very familiar with, I'm sure, is the parable of the 10 virgins. And I think there's something in here that we may overlook, I believe. And that's where I want to draw our attention to, but I want to go through the whole thing to kind of set the table. And we'll begin with Matthew chapter 25, verse 1, and we'll go through verse 13. It says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And so I just want to pause here to fill in the scene a little better of what's taking place here. Now, we know the 10 virgins represent purity. And the lamps, as the Bible tells us, that thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So the lamps represent the word of God. In the oil, there were 5 that had it. They were considered wise. And there were 5 that didn't. And they were considered foolish. This oil represents the Holy Spirit. And even more so than that, it is the working of the Holy Spirit within the lives, because it said that the wise had the oil in their vessels. And so But even with all of this, they were all sleeping. And sleeping is not a good thing, especially in the times that we're living in now. People should be wide awake. And so we want to look at one more piece of the puzzle that we understand clearly what is going on. Is it says that they went forth to meet the bridegroom. Now, who is this bridegroom? And of course, we know the bridegroom is Jesus. But I want to read a few verses to you to reassure and confirm that that is true. And even so, to tell us who this bride is. If there's a bridegroom, it would be good to know the bride. And in Revelation chapter 19, verses 7 through 9, it says, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he saith unto me, Write, Blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God." And so these 10 virgins represent those who are invited unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. But who is the bride? Well, it tells us in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 2, it says, "And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband." You see, it is the ushering in of the fifth kingdom that we see in Daniel chapter 7. This fifth kingdom is God's kingdom. It will be ushered in for eternity. And this represents the New Jerusalem. Now, those virgins who are going to make up the community of this New Jerusalem will be the wise ones. They have allowed the working of the Holy Spirit within them. The five foolish neglected that work. Now, I would like to read with you a few more verses. In Romans chapter 2, verse 13, it says, "For not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified." So those who know the word of God, they will be obeying it. We are not saved by our works, but by our fruits we shall be known. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21 says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven." So we need to be doing the will of the Father. That's wisdom. That is the working of the Holy Spirit within the heart. And in 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 1 through 5, it tells us this. It says, "This know also, that in the last days," and we are living in the last days, I truly believe that. It says that perilous times shall come. "For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away." This is the five foolish. They represented purity. They also had the word of God, but they had only the form of godliness. They denied that power. That power is the working of the Holy Spirit within the life to change that character, to be fit to be allowed to enter into the kingdom of heaven. This is the work that needs to be done within all of us. Let's continue on. In verse 6 of Matthew chapter 25, with the parable, it says, "And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you, but go ye rather to them that sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh." You see, character cannot be bought or sold. It's over a lifetime as we allow the working of the Holy Spirit to change our characters. So many I have heard, my own personal experience, say, well, they have been saying Jesus is coming for a long time and he's not come. And so they tell me that when I see the Sunday law, then I'll start getting ready. And my caution is, that may be too late. And so this work should have been going on for some time already. But I want to share more on that. But before I do, I want to look at something that I believe each of us should have, you know, as important as character development is, and it certainly is. There's an aspect I believe that should be our motivation, because if our main concern is our own salvation, excuse me, and the development of character, then I believe that our motives are misdirected. As I want to ask a question of those of you, especially who are parents, if you have a child, what happens to them does concern you. If they're hurting, you hurt. You love them. And yet, somehow we think to disconnect God and his feelings from us because we are considered his children. And when bad things happen to us, it affects him. He feels the same pain that you as a parent would feel if your child was cheated, was murdered, was raped, was treated unjustly. God feels all of those things. He suffers with us, and his suffering is real. God has feelings beyond what we can even imagine. And so he's not insensitive to the lives that we live or how we treat other people. And so I believe that our motive should be more than our salvation, but the sufferings of Christ, because you see, in this great controversy, God is on trial. The whole universe is watching because Lucifer made some very strong claims against God's government. And so it is to be played out to see if these accusations are true or not. And we need to consider these things. Are we demonstrating that God's law is just, that his character is true, and that it's a character of love? It must be demonstrated in our lives. I want to read a quote from you from Desire of Ages, page 83, and I want to say that I am very thankful that God has given his end-time church a prophet to give us, I suppose, the scenes behind the scenes. And so here she says, "It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour each day in contemplation of the life of Christ. We should take it point by point and let the imagination grasp each scene, especially the closing ones. As thus we dwell upon his great sacrifice for us, our confidence in him will be more constant, our love will be quickened, and we shall be more deeply imbued with his spirit. If we would be saved at last, we must learn the lesson of penitence and humiliation at the foot of the cross." And so what I would like to do in this message is to take a look at one of these scenes to draw our attention to the sufferings of Christ. And hopefully that this would make it our motive. But there's also a deeper message of caution here that I would like to bring out after this. So please stay with me. Many of you are familiar with the story of the Garden of Gethsemane. It was the Thursday evening before the crucifixion of Christ. Now, Christ knew his mission, and he knew what was going to take place the next day. And so he took his most beloved disciples, Peter, James, and John, with him into the garden. And he asked them to pray with him while he was praying, and while he was taking upon himself the sins of this world, that you and I may not have to do that. And this was the experience I want to share with you. Just a couple paragraphs here, and this is also taken from the wonderful book, A Desire of Ages, and this is taken from page 687. It says, "The human heart longs for sympathy and suffering. This longing Christ felt to the very depths of his being. In the supreme agony of his soul, he came to his disciples with a yearning desire to hear some words of comfort from those whom he had so often blessed and comforted and shielded in sorrow and distress. The one who had always had words of sympathy for them was now suffering superhuman agony. And he longed to know that they were praying for him and for themselves. Does Christ have feelings? Yes. It goes on to say, how dark seemed the malignity of sin. Terrible was the temptation to let the human race bear the consequences of its own guilt, while he stood innocent before God. If he could only know that his disciples understood and appreciated this, he would be strengthened. Did you know that we can strengthen God? Rising with painful effort, he staggered to the place where he had left his companions, but he findeth them asleep. Had he found them praying, he would have been relieved. Had they been seeking refuge in God that satanic agencies might not prevail over them, he would have been comforted by their steadfast faith. And yet, he found them sleeping. And that's my caution. Are we sleeping? As Seventh-day Adventists, we should not be sleeping. Again, I'll get to that in a moment. But Hebrews chapter 6, verse 6 says, if they shall fall away, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put him to open shame. When we call ourselves Christians and sin, it grieves God, because we claim to be like him, and yet we're not living like him. We're not demonstrating to the other worlds that God's law is just, and God is a loving God. And it says that we put him to open shame. Matthew chapter 25 and verse 40, it says, and the king shall answer and say unto them, verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. So we can relieve the sufferings of God. We can bring him comfort even today by doing unto others, helping them. That brings peace and comfort to God to see that we care about those that he loved and died for. And even more so than that, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 12 says, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God. You see, there were five wise and five foolish. The five, well, actually, all ten were looking for the appearing of Jesus Christ. But the five wise were not just looking for, but they were hastening unto the coming of the Lord. They were doing something about it. They were doing good unto the children of God. They were allowing that work of the Holy Spirit within themselves. And you know, this kind of sums it up here. In Christ Object Lessons, page 69, and Character Development, it says, Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself and his church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. He's waiting. He's waiting for you and I. It goes on to say, it is the privilege of every Christian not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Were all who profess his name bearing fruit to his glory, how quickly the world would be sown with the seed of the gospel. Quickly the last great harvest would be ripened, and Christ would come to gather the precious grain. You see, we were created in the likeness and the image of Christ in the beginning, but sin had its effect and changed man. But it is the work of the great controversy to reproduce within man the likeness and the image of God again. Then he will come to get his own. And that's what the Bible says in Acts chapter 3, verse 19. It says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. That word when should be correctly translated so that. So when you read this verse, it says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out so that the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. It is the same as Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in the church. Christ is waiting. He's waiting for us to allow that work of the Holy Spirit to be done within us. And yet, you know, here is my point. What I'm trying to draw you to is this. I guess it's kind of what I say, a reality check. perhaps. And this, I say, is in a question I would like to ask you. Would you like to be part of the five foolish? Or would you like to be part of the five wise? And this is where my caution is. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 25 and verse 6. And let's read that. It says, "And at midnight there was a cry made, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him.'" Now who is making this cry? I'd like to read a quote to you. This is taken from Christ's Object Lessons, page 406. It says, "At midnight the cry is heard, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him.' The sleepers suddenly awaken, spring to their feet. They see the procession moving on, bright with torches and glad with music. They hear the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride." This is what wakens them. They hear the voice of the bridegroom, which is Jesus. Jesus speaks through us, through his word. He uses nature and he uses people. Now the bridegroom, we said, is the New Jerusalem. But the city can't speak, but that city is going to be filled with people. And these are God's people. And it's through God's people that God speaks. And so who is giving this cry? I say that it is God's people, and it should be Seventh-day Adventists. We shouldn't desire to be part of the five wise. We have been given a calling. We are to be giving that cry. And I want to share with you, too, why I'm convinced that this is true, that those who are going to be giving that midnight cry should be and will be Seventh-day Adventists. In Review and Herald, March 1, 1887, it says, "Divine and human agencies are combined in the work of saving souls. God has done his part, and Christian activity is needed now. God calls for this. He expects his people to bear a part in presenting the light of truth to all nations. Who will enter into this partnership with the Lord Jesus Christ? He will prescribe the terms. He will make all the conditions. Has God enlightened you with the knowledge of himself? Have the treasures of his word been opened to your understanding so that you have become intelligent in regard to the truths therein? Then go to work with your ability. God uses people. Now, if he has given you an understanding of his word, our counsel is to go forward and do that work. And we as Seventh-day Adventists have been raised up for this work, especially for this time. Have we fallen asleep? God uses human agencies as his voice. Now, I think also there are other clues that we can use to show that this is true, that this cry that is being made should be Seventh-day Adventists. And I want to draw your mind back, and that's why I said this message is particularly geared to Seventh-day Adventists, to a time in the late 1830s and early 1840s. There were those who were giving the cry that Jesus was coming again, but to their disappointment in 1843, Jesus didn't come. They came to understand that they had the year incorrectly. But in the summer of fall of 1844, they gave the cry at midnight. And this was given along with the second angel's message. And I want to read a quote given from that time. It says that angels were sent to the humble, devoted ones and constrained them to raise the cry, "Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him." Those entrusted with the cry made haste. Have we been entrusted with that cry? That was the purpose we were raised up for. It says, "And in the power of the Holy Spirit sounded the message and aroused their discouraged brethren. This work did not stand in the wisdom and learning of men, but in the power of God, and his saints who heard the cry would not resist it." You see, there were those who made the cry, and those that heard it and raised up. They did not resist it. Another quote here taken from 9th Testimonies, page 155. It says, "Pride and weakness of faith are depriving many of the rich blessings of God. There are many who, unless they humble their hearts before the Lord, will be surprised and disappointed when the cry is heard, 'Behold, the bridegroom cometh.' They have the theory of the truth, but they have no oil in their vessels with their lamps. Our faith at this time must not stop with an assent to or belief in the theory of the third angel's message." Do you see the connection she makes here with the midnight cry and the third angel's message? I do not know of any other denomination that has been given that calling to share that third angel's message other than Seventh-day Adventists. Here we see that direct connection of that cry at midnight and the third angel's message. This is the message that we should be given, and I want to caution to say that if we are awakened by this message, I'm concerned. Because James 4:17 says, "To him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin." God has told us, those Seventh-day Adventists who have a clear understanding of the purpose and the message given to us who have not been given it, I do not believe will be part of the five wise, because they should have been giving that cry. So please, let's not be asleep. Let's be diligent in the work that God has given us. Now I understand that there will be those in the pews who the truth has been hidden from them in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. God understands. They will also hear that cry and accept it. But I think the five wise, in my understanding, is more for those, as Jesus has said in John chapter 10, verse 16, "And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also must I bring." God's church is not made up of just Seventh-day Adventists. I believe God has an end-time organized church, which is the Seventh-day Adventist movement. But there are those who will make up God's church that are not of his fold. Those are the five wise, I believe. And so we need to be faithful to be giving that call. That is our duty. And that is my caution. Let's be awake and let's be part of those giving the midnight cry. Revelation chapter 18 points to the time when, as the result of rejecting the threefold warning of Revelation chapter 14, 6 through 12, the church will have fully reached the condition foretold by the second angel. And the people of God still in Babylon will be called upon to separate from her communion. This message is the last that will be ever given to the world. Those people need to hear that message, that last message given to the world. We can't be asleep. We need to be awake. So my caution is, we should not find it a comfort to be part of the five wise, but to be giving that cry. Or we may be missing out on the kingdom of heaven. In closing, I want to read some words from Paul, found in Romans chapter 13, verse 11. It says, "And that, knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed." I believe Jesus is coming very soon, and I'm thankful for this crisis that has come upon the world to awaken us. God is longing to have his people come to him. How much longer are we going to keep him in the most holy place and allow the sufferings of Christ to continue? We can play our part. We can hasten that day. So please, let's be part, I pray, of giving that cry at midnight. "Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him." May God bless you. May you be encouraged and trust fully in him. He will see you through. I thank you.